So now this is Christian Kellner.
I didn't do anything yet.
Great. Okay, I'm Christian. I'm working in Red Hat's desktop hardware enablement team, which is a relatively young team trying to make hardware work, surprisingly, which Thunderbolt is one of. And so the big question to start with the whole thing is, what is this Thunderbolt anyway? And according to Intel, it's the USB-C that does it all, and including, I guess, confusing people, because, you know, it's the Thunderbolt that is a USB. But I guess what they mean is the connector, because it's using the same type of connector that USB-C also uses. It's just a different underlying technology, but the same connector. It is a bit faster than the normal USB-C, providing up to 40 gigabits of transfer powers. It can do 4 PCI Express lanes, but up to, it might also be just 2, depending on the laptop that you have. It can do, according to Intel, 8 DisplayPort lanes, but they're in like 2 streams, so it's like 2 times 4 actually, and it's also up to 2 times 4. It's also depending on which hardware you have. And it's actually not so easy sometimes to find this out. Sometimes you actually have to contact the people and ask them, like, what is in this laptop? And there's Reddit people, like, post on Reddit, there's like, what hardware is actually in my computer, and people don't know. It also provides actually USB 3.1, which is nice. So it's actually also a USB type connector that it provides USB. You can daisy chain up to 6 Thunderbolt devices. You can charge your laptop with up to 100 watts. And the laptop itself can provide up to 15 watts to the devices, which is basically implementing the USB power delivery specification. It's mainly supposed to be used for external graphics cards and docks, but it can also do networking, which I'm going to talk a tiny bit later. So how does this thing very simple look from like on the physical level? It is by having a Thunderbolt controller chip, which is connected with this, what I said, up to 4 lanes of PCI Express lanes to the platform controller hub, I think. Yeah. It also gets the DisplayPort input from your integrated GPU, or if you have a discrete GPU, it can also feed into this. And then it all bundles it into this one Thunderbolt cable. And then on the client side, there's another Thunderbolt controller, which is basically the same as here, but in device mode. And there you unpack either the PCI stream, if you want, and you can connect your external GPU to it, or you unpack the DisplayPort stream, and you can do the DisplayPort thing. People haven't seen a USB Type-C connector, this is how it looks like. This is the USB Type-C connector, and this is a USB Type-C connector that Lenovo uses. And here's the quiz question, obviously. Which of the 2 ports is the Thunderbolt port? Right? Which one? So I actually got someone like writing in to me and saying like he tried to get Thunderbolt working with Linux and it doesn't work until like after back and forth looking at log files and everything, he figured out he was plugging it into this port, which looks like the one you're supposed to plug things into, but it is only a USB port with charging capabilities because the little Thunderbolt logo is on this port, so this is the Thunderbolt port. And I don't know who thought that this was a good idea. So this is a good one, this is a bad one. So in theory, what the port provides is different connection modes. It can act as basically USB only, so you plug in a USB device, you get USB. It can provide as DisplayPort only, you plug in a DisplayPort, and hopefully, depending on what hardware you have, Hans could tell you more about this, you get a DisplayPort. And then there's also mixed version of this, the DisplayPort and USB version. But for us, most relevant actually is you're also, if it's a Thunderbolt port, you actually also get the full Thunderbolt support. And it can any do either of these things, depending on you know, the alternate mode this thing is. And also in the BIOS, you can select between, depending on the BIOS, but most BIOS provide either full Thunderbolt support or only DisplayPort, or only, so you can go into your BIOS and select, and then it would not do Thunderbolt anymore. Since you saw in the other picture, it actually provides PCI express lanes tunnels, which means it comes with some security issues or attack vectors, right? Because via PCI Express, you can get DMA access, and there have been some proof of concept applications and hardware to steal people's memory over some evil device that you just plug into the computer, into a MacBook or something, and you can read the memory and yada, yada, yada. So in the third iteration of the Thunderbolt specification, Intel thought it might be a good idea to implement some security modes. And there are different security modes that you can select in the BIOS. There's none, which basically is the old one from Thunderbolt 2, which means you don't get any security. You just plug in a Thunderbolt device and all the PCI express lanes will automatically be created. And yeah, that's it. Then there's a thing called user mode, where you plug the device in, the kernel sees it, and you create a sysfs device, and you have to actually authorize the device. You have to say, yes, I want to work with this device. And only after you authorize the device, the PCI express lanes will be created. And then there's a third one, a secure mode, which is actually called secure mode, where you also, before you create the PCI express lanes, you can challenge the device with a key that you, in the first connect, provide to the device and write it into its non-volatile memory. And then every on subsequent connects, you can challenge the device with this key, and the kernel will make sure that it is the device that has the same key as you gave it. The default that I've seen on most laptops, actually all laptops I had in my hands, is actually user mode, so the middle one. And then there's also two other modes, which is basically DisplayPort only mode or USB only mode, also selectable in the BIOS. Yeah, and how does this look in Windows? You get a bunch of dialog boxes because, you know, you have to ask people if they want it and yada, yada, yada. And Chimek, I'm not sure if he's in the room. I don't know, but Chimek spent a lot of time to design-wise to try to avoid us having to do the same. So I'm going to talk about this in a tiny bit later. Exactly. So what we basically did to enable these security modes is that we have a small system daemon, which is called Bolt, that talks to the kernel and observes via UDEV events that there's new devices. And then the daemon itself doesn't do anything but provides the devices on dbus. And then GNOME Control Center, GNOME Shell, or the command line can actually react to this and authorize devices and stuff like this. So this provides the interface to the kernel, but the policy, or at least the initial policy, actually comes from other programs, mainly the GNOME Shell in GNOME. The kernel interface is just a very simple sysfs interface where you have device files where you can write, you know, I mean, to authorize a device, you just write, you know, you write a one into a file called authorized of the device, and that will authorize the device. And if you want to do the key verification, so if you're in secure mode, then you have a file called key, and then you can write a random key into that device file, engrave the key via the one into the device, and subsequent connects, you can say, here's the key, and now please connect if the key matches the one that is in the device. We can also do firmware updates because in Thunderbolt level, the Thunderbolt controller has its own firmware. So you can update your firmware of the host, but also of the devices. And some cable that are active, the cable also is a Thunderbolt device. So now with this cool thing, you can actually update the firmware of your cables, which is really cool. Yes, so I said already this, like the Bolt daemon provides, it's a small daemon that gets activated only on demand, so if you don't have Thunderbolt hardware, if you don't plug anything into the Thunderbolt port, you should not even see this thing. And it provides a DBus API for for clients, and it can use to authorize and enroll devices, and we hopefully secure via Polkit, and it has a database where you can, you know, record devices that you've already authorized. So in subsequence connects, it will automatically authorize the devices. And we have like a more paranoid mode if you are on like a conference and you have to plug in your computer into random cables that are lying around, where we don't actually do that. So you can disable automatic authorization in the control center. I'm not going to go into this, but maybe for future reference, the API we provide is actually quite simple. And reflects basically most of what is on SysFS. And there's also a command line program that you could use if you want to tweak more things, because we don't expose everything in GNOME settings. So if you want to do more things, and I mean, this is not even completely up to date anymore. There's a few more commands. But basically, there's a small command line thing called bold kittle in the good kittle fashion of journal kittle and whatnot. I blame Leonard, because Leonard is probably blamed for everything. And how does our policy in GNOME Shell work? So the idea is that we don't want to ask user questions that they're not qualified to answer. And if you plug the device in and you present the user with a question, do you want to enable this device? What the user going to say? Obviously, you want to enable this device. So we're not going to ask user if they want to enable this device. So what we basically assume that if you have a device in your hand and you plug it yourself into the GNOME session and the GNOME session is unlocked, you know what you're doing, and we authorize the device, which might be true or not, but that's what I think that's the best we can do, actually. If the session is locked, we're not going to do anything, and you get this kind of screen where there is a notification saying that you plugged the Thunderbolt device in, but we didn't authorize it because your session was locked. We also provide, because creating the PCI Express tunnels can actually take quite a bit of time, we also provide a bit of feedback to the user, which there's a little icon here in the status area, I think it's called, of GNOME Shell, indicating that something is going on your Thunderbolt bus while you wait until the device is connecting. The little icon is called the cable snake after Florian. this is how the GNOME settings panel looks, where you can disable the functionality of the authorization if you're on a conference and you don't want to have this, and you can also manage your devices. Or if you plugged in the device while your screen was locked, but you know it's good, you trust this device, then you can also hit this button and we will actually authorize it. And then recently in Network Manager, we also enabled Thunderbolt networking, which means that you can actually connect two computers via a Thunderbolt cable, and then you get automatically a connection between the two. And then you can transfer files between or SSH into it or something. I mean, the coolest thing that I could think of this, and I think Alberto had the same idea independently, was if we had a migration assistant or something where you have like an old laptop and a new laptop and you just connect the two, and then we could transfer all the data that you have over this, that would be awesome. Maybe someone can write that. And then there's a not too long to do, but there is a to do because, if you use the dock for your computer, then most likely you have a keyboard connected to the dock. And then if you have an encrypted hard drive, you might want to enter your password, your Linux password, via the keyboard that is attached to the dock, which is not yet authorized. So we need to get somehow authorization into either pre-boot or early boot. And so with a new kernel and with a new Thunderbolt firmware, there's something called boot ACL, where you can write the UUIDs of the devices that you want to authorize already during BIOS, like pre-boot, into the non-volatile memory of the Thunderbolt controller, and then the Thunderbolt controller will authorize it even in the BIOS, and you can use your mouse and keyboard in the BIOS. But it has a bit of downsides, and the downside is that, first of all, the kernel interface is a bit stupid. It's a list of UUIDs, and we have no way to know whether, like, we can write to it and it will work, but we don't know whether you actually have enabled it in the BIOS, because by default in the BIOS, it's on most hardware, it's off. So you have to actually go into the BIOS, enable it, and then on Dell, which is good, on Dell hardware will actually get a warning box saying this will render your computer insecure. And you're like, should I really do this? I'm not sure. And then from user space, we can tell whether you actually enabled it or not, so not so great. So we might have to work on something called the early boot support, where we actually in the init RAMFS or in the init RD have a small binary, a small helper that already authorizes devices. And maybe with this, we can also support secure mode. But this is ongoing work. Then I recently tried external graphics card support, and expectedly, it does not work at all. So with the, I mean, I only have an NVIDIA card, and with the NVIDIA card, Novo crashes, and also the binary driver crashes, and renders your computer absolutely useless. So don't plug it in just yet. and also, currently, I'm the only one actually touching this code, so it has a bus factor of 1, and not only during Grodic. So maybe you want to increase that. By at least a few other people. And there's not that much, the code split is actually quite small. So if someone feels to like hack on that, that'd be great. All right, thank you.
Questions?
These modifications, have they landed in upstream GNOME yet? Or when are, when, and the kernel side as well?
That is actually a very good question. Yeah, I actually want to have a slide on that, but apparently I forgot. So Bolt is in, the daemon is in Fedora 28. And the settings panel is also in Fedora 28. Although the GNOME changes on GNOME settings only landed in 330? 330, yeah. So we backported it for Fedora. But I think Ubuntu also ships at least a daemon, although I'm not sure whether they backported the settings panel. I don't know. But the daemon, you backported it? Oh, yeah. So if you have Ubuntu or Fedora, you're fine. I think Arch has the daemon. I'm not sure what else they do. yeah. But the kernel stuff, so the first supported kernel is 4.13. And if you want to have the boot ACL stuff, you need 4.17.